My name is Reverend Anthony Evans, and I'm president of the National Black Church Initiative. This is a coalition of 34,000 African-American churches coming together on a variety of issues. We originally started as a health initiative, and we expanded our core programming to education and housing and several other issues, financial literacy. But today, we are here to deal with the issue of education. And I'm very happy to invite to the pulpit Admiral David Brewer. Please join us in the pulpit, please.
Well, it's wonderful to be here, Reverend Davis. Thank you for hosting this. Reverend Evans, thank you for putting on this forum. And to the people who I'm quite sure are going to see this on film, thank you for viewing it. And thank you, everyone who is present today. Almost 40 years ago, I raised my hand and I said, I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. During my almost 36 years of service in the United States Navy, it became quite apparent to me that no one, absolutely no one, no foreign power was going to defeat us militarily. But as I began to look around at our country, it became equally as apparent that we were threatened by three things: that our national security, our economy, our way of life, our freedom was being threatened by ignorance, poverty, and crime. We were literally deteriorating from within. And so after reading the book Halftime, by Bob Buford, where he says, the first part of your life you focus on success or your job or whatever your career ambitions are. And then in the second half of your life, you focus on what's important, what is significant. So I made a commitment, a tremendous commitment as it turns out, to step into the arena of trying to defeat these three enemies of ignorance, poverty, and crime. And lo and behold, I received a phone call out of the blue in July of 2006 when someone said, someone has submitted your name to be a candidate for superintendent of the Los Angeles Unified School District. And since we're in church, I won't tell you what my response was. But it started with an H. And so I said, okay. So I made that leap. I stepped into that breach, as we say. And let me tell you something. After 36 years in the United States Navy, traveling the world, basically being at sea for months at a time and dealing in very stressful conditions, being superintendent of the Los Angeles Unified School District was the toughest job I'd ever had in my life. And I think I'll get an amen from General Becton, who was the former chancellor of the D.C. Public Schools, a honored and well-awarded general officer in the United States Army, and also the president of my alma mater, Prairie View A&M University. And I'm quite sure General Becton will tell you the same story. The reason I am standing here today is because nobody has solved this problem. If we could very well be here 10 years from now having the same forum. Because I can tell you point blank, I was before the Congressional Black Caucus in the late 80s talking about the same thing. Yet the trends continue. So my position right now is that we are at a crossroads. We can either go down the path of greatness, or we can go down the path of decline. And that decline is a red path of ignorance, poverty, and crime. And that is why I'm standing here today. Because the trends right now in our country are alarming. Now, as educators, there's a lot of educators in this room. I don't have to tell you about the dropout rate and all of those things. You know that for yourself. Okay? But there are some other issues that we're having to deal with, because it is not only affecting black and brown children, it is affecting everybody. When our 15-year-olds rank 17th in the world in science, that's everybody. When I have a philosophy, it's very simple. You can't run from this, you can't hide from this, you can't build enough guarded gates to defend yourself against this. This will eventually catch up with you. We're now looking at this tremendous recession in this country. Let me tell you something. Part of that is our own ignorance of our own financial system. That's a part of the issue here. We are looking at the first year in the decline in life expectancy. Why? Because we have one of the worst life expectancies in the entire world. I will talk a little bit more about that later. We rank 49th in the world in life expectancy. Yet, we brag about our great healthcare system. Something's wrong here. Something is definitely wrong. So, we need a different approach. We can't continue to do the same thing. As Einstein said, you know, to keep doing the same thing and expect different results is a reflection of insanity. So you need a broader and bolder approach. You need a holistic approach. Now, prominent scholars and superintendents got together here recently, and we talked about a different approach. You cannot discount poverty. You cannot discount racism. You cannot discount all of the factors that are impacting the education of black and brown children. You can't do that. You have to confront those issues. And we're blessed today to have Elaine Weiss, who is the executive director of the Broader and Bolder Approach, and you will clearly hear more from her later. But there's something else that's happening here. We have to look at a child in a holistic manner. A child is born. A child proceeds through our education system and becomes an adult. We have to understand that those are developmental stages in all of those areas. In other words, from birth all the way through school to job, etc. So why is it that when we look at our children, millions of them end up incarcerated? Why? What goes wrong between birth and the time that they're supposed to finish high school and maybe be entering college that they end up incarcerated? We're lucky today and blessed today to have Monique Brown, the wife of the great legendary Hall of Fame football player, with us today, and she will be discussing a little bit more about this prisoner education program and rehabilitation program. But we need a paradigm shift. I submit this because I have traveled so much, and we're going to talk about travel. As a naval officer, you get to see a lot of things. My shipmate is here, Vice Admiral Lee Gunn. A good friend of mine for clearly over 25, almost 30 years. And Lee will tell you point blank that we see the world. We see the world within a context. And when we look at the world and we look at the emerging nations, the nations, even Japan, even though they're going through a tough time right now, those nations are emerging. And the reason that they are emerging and are getting ready to move past us is because of their education system. And they made a paradigm shift years ago that we have not made. And that is, we are holding on to this agrarian-inspired education system that says we can only educate children for 180 days. That's ridiculous. That is ridiculous. We are no longer on farms. Our children do not belong in the streets during the summer. They belong in somebody's nurturing academic or enrichment program during the summer. When our daughter was in school in Guam, she had Asian classmates. And when the first thing she came home and she says, "Daddy, my Asian classmates are in school on Saturday." "Oh, really?" "Yes. My Asian classmates go to school after we get home." "Really?" "My Asian classmates are in school during the summer." "Really?" There's a correlation here. And that correlation is the emerging tigers of Asia. Trust me, they are getting ready to consume us. So when I was a superintendent in Los Angeles, I kept looking for an education model that would finally break this cycle. Because see, in Los Angeles, I had 76% of my children were at or below the poverty line. They were poor. 11% of my population was African American and about 72% was Latino. Brown and black poor. So I said, wait a minute, we have got to figure out a way to fix this problem. God works in mysterious ways. As you've heard, I am from Orlando, Florida. And so as I was looking around the nation and doing all of my research, I found the program, a foundational program in Orlando, Florida called the Tangelo Park Program. Now, Tangelo was called the Wild, Wild West about 20 years ago. Drug dealers ruling the streets. So finally, the community activists in Tangelo said, we are tired of this. We are sick and tired of this. So they partnered with Harris Rosen, the largest private hotel chain owner in the state of Florida, to fund a program that was holistic, that basically started with the babies. And so what they did was, they said, well, wait a minute, we have to control this. We have to take this and move it outside of the political cycle. You see, I'm not going to knock politicians here today, but let me just say this, that the United States military is the most revered institution in America. We have about a 70 or 80% approval rating. The least revered are the politicians. They're below freezing. And there's a reason for that. Not that they're bad people, but they are caught up in a system that cycles you every 4, 6, and 8 years. And so they make decisions every 4, 6, 8 years rather than letting programs sustain themselves. So the people in Tangelo said, we're not going to put up with that. We're going to take control of our kids. We're going to take control of our neighborhood. And so they created something called a community advisory board. That is a retired principle, because in any program that you're going to institute, including the National Black Church Initiative, if you're going to institute any program around education, then an educator has to lead it. You need to have someone in education lead it. So a retired principal is leading this effort. Harris Rosen funds it, and then you have everybody else. You have the parents, you have the social services, you have all of the wraparound services, you have the YMCA, and you also have the sheriff, the police. Because they need to be an integral part of your community. Because there are so many concerns about health care, they also went out and hired an extra nurse to take care of the babies in the early childhood center as well as in the elementary school. And because 85% of brain development occurs between birth and 5, they focus a lot of their efforts on the early childhood education program. Then they put all of the support systems on the campus, so it made it accessible to the families. Okay, it's working. Then they did something very smart. You know, we brag about college acceptance. Oh, man, everybody's rah, rah, rah. Everybody's accepted. You've been accepted to college. One problem. Our college dropout rate is worse than our high school dropout rate. As you saw in my alarming statistics, 57% of our best and brightest students finish college after 6 years. So Tangelo recognized this, and so they put a dedicated counselor into the high school that basically what we call loops with the child from ninth grade all the way through to college graduation. Because the goal is not get accepted to college. The goal is to finish college and get a job. And they recognize that. Then, because there are 4 factors involved in children dropping out of college, and I have Dr. Fred Humphreys here, who is the esteemed President Emeritus of Florida A&M University, and he will get deeper into this, but there are basically 4 reasons why kids drop out of college. Number 1 is financial. So what do? They went and created a full college scholarship safety net program, including room and board. So a child that goes to college out of the Tangelo Park program, after they go out and get all the money that they possibly can, then the Tangelo Park community covers the rest. So they took care of the number 1 reason why kids drop out of college. The number 2 reason is academics. So because they have a full service YMCA, kids are not off during the summer. They do academic enrichment programs during the summer. The next thing is social adjustment and parents. And the social adjustment and the parenting is covered by that counselor. She will tell you point blank that she is on the phone to 10 o'clock at night talking to her college students. So what are the results? You know, a lot of people have great programs. But what are the results? 100% high school graduation. How about that? We have 70% of the entering first graders. This is the one that gets me. Because they started with those babies, 70% of the entering first graders are reading at or above the first grade level. And these poor black kids in Tangelo Park, poor black kids, won the state of Florida's literacy award in 2009. And their school is one of the top performing schools in the entire state of Florida. Now here's the biggie. Remember, begin with the end in mind, and that is college graduation. Tangelo Park, poor African-American kids have a college graduation rate higher than Asians. Let me say that again, higher than Asians. You see, when we do something right, when you do it in a holistic manner, great things happen. Now, instead of having prisoners, they've got PhDs. They've already graduated, one lawyer, they've already got a PhD, they've got 13 masters, they've got well over 100 bachelor's degrees. Now, this is a very small program, by the way. A very small program. But here's the biggie. Remember who was on that community action board? The sheriff. Okay? And the sheriff will tell you that of all the neighborhoods now in Orlando, Tangelo Park is one of the safest neighborhoods now in Orlando. They've had a 52% reduction in crime in that neighborhood. Why? Because they have collaborated around the children and the families in that neighborhood. But more importantly, housing values have doubled in the neighborhood. Because when you create safety and security, you follow Maslow's hierarchy of needs, that's food, shelter, and security, you create economic growth. And so now the cost of reducing the cost for educating children are now declining. Tangelo is a small program, very small program. So I have a philosophy. You think big, you start small, and then you scale fast. We are now in the scale fast mode. We have to take a Tangelo Park plus everything else that we know as educators and move from there. And where do you start? Yesterday I attended the groundbreaking of EduCare over in Anacostia. EduCare is an early childhood education program that starts with babies and goes all the way through to 5 years old. Doris Buffett invited me there. For those of you all who are familiar with Doris Buffett, she is the sister of Warren Buffett. What happened in Tangelo is they recognized what the Perry preschool study found out 40-some years ago, that if you do nothing else, if you educate children in that first 5 years in terms of 85% of their brain development, if you educate them during those first 5 years, their life outcomes will be different. Not only did the Perry preschool study find that out, the Chicago study found that out, the Abedissarian study found that out in North Carolina. It is amazing to me how we have not created a pre-K to 16 or college graduation program in this country. That is amazing to me why we have not figured that out. Because when you do that, you see the outcomes on this particular slide. And so my position is, every baby in this country, whether you are poor or middle class, needs to be in some kind of early education program if we are to continue as a great nation.